So good evening everyone, this is Dr. Singaram. So today I'll be discussing the clinical part of hematology along with MCQs for foreign medical graduates who are appearing for the exams. So mainly I'll be discussing only the clinical part because the other part which is covered in the pathology, okay, like the investigations and all, I would not be concentrating much. I'll be concentrating mainly on the clinical part and something related to the therapeutics of hematological disorders. So before I get started, please note that this discussion is only for academic purposes and cannot be directly related to the patient care. Let's start the discussion with this very simple question which is often asked in your exam. What is the level of hemoglobin which denotes anemia? This is given by World Health Organization depending on the age group. You can see that between 6 months to 5 years, the cutoff is 11 grams per deciliter. Between 5 to 11 years, it is 11.5, and more than 12 years, it is less than 12, which is taken as anemia. In a non-pregnant woman, again, it is less than 12. But for pregnant women, you generally know that there is a dip in hemoglobin. So that is why the cutoff is also lesser at 11 grams per deciliter. In males, usually hemoglobin is on the little higher side. So that is why the cutoff is also higher at 13 grams per deciliter. Any value less than this cutoff will be taken as anemia. And this is one of the very important one-liners often asked in your exams. Let me discuss the first question, which is regarding the iron deficiency anemia. Please note for your exams, iron deficiency is the most common micronutrient deficiency which is associated with anemia. That by itself is an MCQ. The question is, best test to detect iron deficiency in a community with low prevalence of iron deficiency. Okay, the options are PCB, iron binding capacity, serum iron and serum ferritin. So what is the best test to detect iron deficiency anemia among the options which are given? Okay, don't worry about this low prevalence, high prevalence and all. Anywhere, what is that initial test to be done among the following? Yes, most of you must have got the answer as correct because it might have been told in a pathology classes also, and that is important clinically also. What is that? It is serum ferritin. Okay, serum ferritin is the storage form of iron, the levels of which will decrease whenever there is a iron deficiency. Obviously, and serum ferritin is one of the best tests to detect the presence of iron deficiency anemia. Okay, that's a straightforward question you should all be remembering. The next question, a patient with iron deficiency anemia is being started on treatment with oral ferrous sulfate. Which among the following is the earliest indicator of response to oral iron? Please remember, whenever there is iron deficiency anemia, the treatment is supplementation or treatment is with iron. Generally, iron is given only orally. Oral form of iron is what is preferred in the treatment. And generally, what is the formulation of iron which is preferred? Please note, it is always ferrous sulfate. You all know that ferrous sulfate contains 20% of elemental iron, and this is the most economical form of iron and also the very effective form of oral iron. So that is why this form of ferrous sulfate only is often used in the treatment purposes as well as for the community management also. It is always ferrous sulfate, and that by itself is an MCQ question. Please make a note of it. What form of iron is used for oral supplementation or treatment? Please answer as ferrous sulfate. One more question, it contains 20% of elemental iron. Okay, right. Now the question is, which is the indicator of response, and that too they have asked, earliest indicator of response among the following. So what are the options we have? Increase in hemoglobin, reticulocytosis, normalization of serum ferritin, and all of the above. Okay, let me tell you the answer and go to the explanation. The answer is reticulocytosis, increase in the reticulocyte count. Okay, right. Now look at this tabular column, which tells you about the response expected after administration of iron. Please note that the first response usually is subjective improvement. Okay, the patient feels better. Okay, the appetite would have increased, irritability would have decreased, all those things are subjective improvement. That is the first one, you can see by 12 to 24 hours itself. Okay, next is the bone marrow response. Okay, now the bone marrow has got iron for synthesis of hemoglobin. So what does it do? It will start producing more and more of RBC. So that is why initial bone marrow response is erythroid hyperplasia. Please remember, for this erythroid hyperplasia to be noted, you have to take a bone marrow aspiration. But please remember, bone marrow aspiration cannot be taken just like that because it's a very invasive procedure. Okay, you cannot just take a bone marrow aspirate just to look for a response to treatment of iron deficiency. No, you are not going to do that. What is the thing which we do? Okay, we check the blood counts. Okay, and what will you note in the blood count as a first response? Yes, you can notice it here. It is reticulocytosis. Okay, and it is around 48 to 72 hours it starts increasing. Okay, right. And it peaks at 5 to 7 days. Okay. But these fine details will not be asked for you. But what will be asked is the first response in the blood count would be increase in the reticulocyte. That is a question which we were discussing. Okay. Right. Then only comes increase in the hemoglobin level. Can you see that? The increase in hemoglobin by 4 to 30 days. On an average, it is by 1 week. Okay. So by 2 to 3 days, okay, reticulocyte count increases. But hemoglobin increases little later by around 1 week. Okay. Right. And you can see the third point. This is a very, very important point. What is that? 1 to 3 MO. MO means what? Months. Okay. What is happening at 1 to 3 months? It is a repletion of the iron stores. Very, very important. Okay. It will take 1 to 3 months. Why this is very important? Because you have started treatment for iron deficiency. You have asked the patient to come for follow-up. Say like 2 weeks, 3 weeks later, he is coming for follow-up. You check the blood counts. His hemoglobin has normalized. Okay, then there may be a natural thinking to stop the treatment, but that should not be done, because our aim in treatment of iron deficiency anemia is not just normalization of hemoglobin level, but repletion of iron stores, which will take 1 to 3 months. So that is why, to be on the safer side, if they ask you the question, what is the duration of treatment in iron deficiency anemia, please answer as 3 months, because our aim is repletion of iron stores and not just increase in the hemoglobin, right? Okay, this is a very important question. All of you should be remembering it. Generally, I was telling you, iron deficiency anemia is treated by oral iron supplementation, okay? But some conditions, okay, you have to go for this intravenous iron, okay? All of the following are indications for intravenous iron administration except, okay? Options given are intermittent GI blood loss, iron malabsorption, inability to tolerate oral iron, patients on erythropoietin therapy. The question is except. So, which is not an indication is a question. Okay. Right. So, let us see from the options from the last. Patients on erythropoietin therapy, yes, you have to give IV iron only. Why? Because I will tell you the reason. When a patient started on erythropoietin, the rate of erythropoiesis increases. Okay. For that, you need to give so much amount of iron, which cannot be given just by oral iron. Are you able to follow? So to give more amount of iron, we are switching to intravenous iron rather than oral iron once the patient is started on erythropoietin therapy. There are some indication for erythropoietin therapy, which is what is our next question. I'll be discussing that next. But as of now, remember, patients on erythropoietin, it is better to start intravenous iron because you need more amount of iron to be given for erythropoiesis. Simple reason. Next is inability to tolerate the iron. Very, very important. Okay, if the patient is having continuous vomiting or GI disturbances, gastrointestinal disturbances following an iron, you are not going to continue oral iron. Or if the patient is having poor compliance to the treatment, that is, he is not taking properly the oral iron and all, then also you are supposed to switch over to intravenous iron. So this is also an indication for IV iron. Look at the option before that, iron malabsorption. Obviously, when the iron is not absorbed, how are you going to give oral form of iron? That also indicates need for IV iron administration. So what is the answer by exclusion? Always make this habit that if you are not able to just pick up an answer from the four options, always try to rule out the options. Okay, here we have ruled out B, C, D options. Automatically the answer becomes option A. Intermittent GI blood loss is, or gastrointestinal blood loss is, not an indication for IV iron administration. So, what I would want you to remember is to get the fact straight that it is not intermittent GI blood loss, it is persistent gastrointestinal blood loss is an indication, not intermittent. Okay, right. Anyway, so now you are able to answer what are all the indications for intravenous iron administration. Okay, right. Let's see this question. A patient with CKD is found to have a hemoglobin of 8 grams per deciliter. That means this patient is obviously anemic. Now, which among the following is the best possible treatment for this particular patient is the question. Options are oral iron, blood transfusion, parenteral iron and erythropoietin. Remember this point. Okay, whenever patient is having CKD, what is the meaning of CKD? CKD means chronic kidney disease. The point is the kidneys are not functioning. So, that is why these patients generally have deficiency of erythropoietin. Because you all know that the production of erythropoietin, okay, is from the fibroblasts which are located around the peritubular capillaries and in the proximal convoluted tubule. They are the ones which are going to cause production of erythropoietin. When the kidney is not going to function, then erythropoietin deficiency is obviously going to happen in this group of patients. So that is why a CKD patient having a significant anemia like this, the best possible treatment. Remember, the question is best possible treatment. Always remember it is erythropoietin, okay, or erythropoietin substitutes. Okay, that is what we are going to use for this particular set of patients. So this is one specific indication where you are supposed to give erythropoietin itself directly as a treatment of anemia. Okay, answer is CKD, chronic kidney disease. Let's move on to the next question. The next question is, in cobalamin deficiency, which of the following is not seen? What is this cobalamin deficiency? It is B12 deficiency. Which of the following will not be seen? I think it's a straightforward question. You all know that there are two important things. If it's a cobalamin deficiency or a folic acid deficiency, what is that anemia which is going to be seen? You are not going to see microcytic anemia. Instead, you are going to see macrocytic anemia. It's a straightforward, simple question. One of the previous years FMG exam question. Please make a note. It's macrocytic anemia. Okay, right. And you can see the other manifestations. Long track sign, loss of proprioception, and Romberg sign. These are all neurological signs which are seen in addition to anemia in a patient with megaloblastic anemia or B12 deficiency anemia. Neurological signs. Okay. Now, so what are the long tracks I'm talking about? See, the long tracks I'm talking about is in the spinal cord region. Okay. The ones which are commonly affected in case of B12 deficiency are, one is the posterior column. And the second one which is commonly affected is the corticospinal tract. Of course, the lateral spinal thalamic tract also can be affected, but it is a corticospinal tract which is commonly affected next to posterior column. The question for you in the exam is, which is the commonest column which is affected in B12 deficiency? Answer is posterior column or the dorsal column. And in fact, this is what is responsible for this manifestation. What is that? Loss of proprioception. Okay, right. And I think you must be knowing Romberg sign. What is that Romberg sign? Romberg sign means you ask the patient to stand with a heel approximated, two heels touching each other and hands by the side. And then you try to check for his balance with the eyes closed. Okay. If with the eyes closed, okay, the patient is swaying side to side, or if he is showing some ataxia, then that means there is a problem in this proprioception or a posterior column defect. Okay. So all these things are associated with B12 deficiency. What is not associated is microcytic anemia. Instead, there is macrocytic anemia. One more question on this megaloblastic anemia. Changes of megaloblastic anemia which may not be corrected by administering folic acid alone. I told you that the two important causes of megaloblastic anemia are B12 deficiency and folic acid deficiency. So in the treatment, ideally both has to be given, or depending on the specific cause, you can give B12 or folic acid. Okay. Now the question is, if you administer folic acid alone and suppose the patient also had B12 deficiency, which of the following may not be corrected? Please see, hyperplasia of the bone marrow will be corrected, macrocytic RBC will be corrected, but it is a fact for you to remember. I cannot explain to you much. It is a neurological changes, because B12 deficiency is something which is inherently related to the maturation or functionality of myelin, okay, which is what is actually causing the neurological problems and megaloblastic anemia. So what is important for correction of neurological changes? It is administration of B12. Folic acid can correct all the hematological part of megaloblastic anemia, but it may not correct the neurological changes of megaloblastic anemia. In fact, the textbooks go on to say that if you give folic acid alone to a patient having megaloblastic anemia, it may actually exacerbate the neurological changes or aggravate the neurological changes in megaloblastic anemia. So that is why, along with folic acid, vitamin B12 also has to be given in the correction of megaloblastic anemia. Right? Okay. Moving on to the next question, primary mechanism of megaloblastic anemia in blind loop syndrome. Okay, you all must be remembering one thing. I think this must have been covered in your pathology classes as well. Blind loop syndrome is the other name for actually bacterial overgrowth syndrome. Okay, is the other name for bacterial overgrowth syndrome. Okay, wherein the part of the intestine, there is abnormally excess growth of the bacteria. Okay, so what is the problem of this growth of this bacteria? These bacteria, they will interfere, okay, with this B12. In what way? It's not folate. Okay, straight away I'm just telling you, it is not folate. It is mainly related to the B12. In what way? Will they affect the absorption or will they cause deficiency of B12? Please note, they cause B12 deficiency. Why? Because bacteria, when they are proliferating so much, they utilize B12 for their own metabolism. So what happens, the human body is not able to utilize the B12, or it causes deficiency of B12. Okay, it is not going to interfere with the absorption of B12. No, the primary problem, remember the question is primary mechanism. The primary problem is bacteria itself takes up the B12 for its own metabolism, making the patient to be deficient in B12, even if he takes adequate amount of B12. Okay, right. Now, if I just ask you a question, which type of persons are likely to develop B12 deficiency? Please note that strictly vegetarian patients, okay, strict vegans, okay, not even taking cow milk, okay, they are going to be at risk for developing B12 deficiency. That's one of the dietary factors associated with vitamin B12 deficiency. Anyway, answer for this question is it causes vitamin B12 deficiency. Let's move on to the next question. A 20-day-old neonate has recurrent episodes of jaundice with unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. You all know that in a baby having jaundice, it can be either increase in conjugated hyperbilirubinemia or unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Now, this question is very clearly mentioning it's an unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Peripheral smear shows increase in the reticulocyte. Okay, increase in the reticulocyte. There is a family history of anemia with jaundice. What is the likely diagnosis? Now, the word unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia itself helps us to rule out an option. What is that option? There are four options: sickle cell, beta thalassemia, neonatal cholestasis, and hereditary spherocytosis. All but one, there is unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So, which is having conjugated hyperbilirubinemia? Yes, you got it correct. Neonatal cholestasis, you get conjugated bilirubin, which is increasing. Okay, so that option can be eliminated. So that option can be eliminated because we are dealing with unconjugated bilirubin increase. Anyway, that option is over. So you are going to look at the next three ones: sickle cell, beta thalassemia, hereditary spherocytosis. All these are hemolytic disorders, right? All these are hereditary hemolytic disorders. Now, does your question tell you it's a hemolytic disorder? Of course, yes. You can see that there is an increased reticulocyte, which is seen in hemolytic disorders. There is also family history of anemia with jaundice. That means what? It's an inherited hemolytic disorder. That's all. Okay. You all know that there is anemia with jaundice in case of hemolytic disorders, obviously. Now, sickle cell anemia is inherited, beta thalassemia is inherited, hereditary spherocytosis is also inherited. Now, I'll tell you, sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia inherited as autosomal recessive disorders, and hereditary spherocytosis inherited as autosomal dominant disorder. Okay, then what is the answer for this question? Please see the age and presentation. This is a neonate. This is a neonate. Okay, now I will tell you the clue. In sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia, the problem is in the beta chain. The problem is in the beta chain, which is located, which is present in an adult hemoglobin or HbA. But what is the hemoglobin in a neonate? It is not predominantly HbA, it is a fetal hemoglobin or HbF. So obviously you can say that sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia cannot be the answer here because they are going to be not presenting in a neonate. Please remember, beta chain or the HbA becomes the predominant hemoglobin only after 6 months. So that is why sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia major can present only after 6 months of age and they cannot be present in a neonate. Very simply, you can rule out those two options. So that automatically brings us to the question, which is hereditary spherocytosis, which I can just represent in a short form as HS, which is the diagnosis in this particular case. Ready to follow this? Okay, right. Now, hereditary spherocytosis, it's a problem in the cytoskeleton of the RBC. That means what? Structure of the RBC. Okay, it is in the cytoskeleton of RBC. The membrane of the RBC is having some problem. You all know that there are different proteins which make up this cytoskeleton of RBC. What are they? Ankyrin, spectrin, band protein, all those things. And if I ask you the question, which is the most common protein which is associated with a problem in hereditary spherocytosis, please answer as ankyrin. I think this must have been taken in your pathology classes as well. It's a revision for you. Which is the most common defect in case of hereditary spherocytosis? Question, please answer as ankyrin. Okay, right. So that's about this particular question. Moving on to the next question. Which of the following is usually associated with parvovirus B19 infection in patients with hereditary spherocytosis? Now, not only hereditary spherocytosis, any hemolytic disorder or any hemolytic anemia, if there is a parvovirus B19 infection, it can cause bone marrow suppression. It can cause bone marrow suppression. Okay, so what is the obvious problem when the bone marrow is undergoing suppression? It will not produce any of the cells like WBC, RBC and platelet. So the patient goes in for what type of problem? Yes, the answer is aplasia or aplastic crisis. Okay, so the basic reason is parvovirus B19 infection in hemolytic disorders, okay, will cause bone marrow suppression and cause aplastic crisis. Hereditary spherocytosis is just one example. It can occur in other type of hemolytic disorder like sickle cell or beta thalassemias also. Okay, which of the following organism causes infection following a splenectomy? Right, now what happens in conditions, okay, like in hereditary spherocytosis itself, where spleen is the site of destruction of RBCs, these patients can have a huge splenomegaly, causing more destruction of RBCs. So that is why we can actually plan splenectomy for patients having hereditary spherocytosis as a part of a treatment also. Okay, but there is one problem if you remove the spleen. What is that? As you can see from the options, the child becomes prone for infection with some bacteria. Okay, you are given so many options: E. coli, Klebsiella, Pneumococcus and Pseudomonas. Which one will you choose? Which is more common to cause infection following a splenectomy? Answer is going to be Pneumococcus, because what happens? Spleen is something which will trap and kill the encapsulated bacteria. That means bacteria having capsules, okay, encapsulated bacteria. So what happens once the spleen is removed? These encapsulated bacteria will not be engulfed by the splenic macrophages and they cannot be killed. So that's why they cause infection. Okay, one of the typical example and the most common infection to occur is Pneumococcus. There are other infections also which are possible following splenectomy. That means basically other encapsulated bacteria. What are all the other encapsulated bacteria? It is Meningococcus and Haemophilus influenza type B, H influenza type B. Okay, they are the other organisms which are likely to cause infection. All these, what is common to all these things? They are encapsulated bacteria. That is why all the patients, okay, all the patients whom we are planning to do splenectomy, always give vaccination against Pneumococcus, Meningococcus and Haemophilus influenza type B before performing splenectomy. And after splenectomy also, to reduce the risk of this infection, you have to give prophylactically antibiotics. Which antibiotic do you think would be given prophylactically for these patients following splenectomy? Yes, penicillin. Prophylactic penicillin should be given following splenectomy for these patients. These are all some of the important, very, very important questions often asked in your exams. Moving on to the next question, a case history. A 21-year-old male presents with severe anemia. He gives a history of similar presentation 3 years back, which was adequately managed with single blood transfusion. He has not required any further blood transfusion till date. Most likely diagnosis. Here is a severe anemia. You can see that hemoglobin is just 5 grams per deciliter. So it's a severe anemia. There was a similar history 3 years back also, which was managed with a blood transfusion. So what could be the diagnosis? Okay, he has not required any other blood transfusion till date. So generally remember all these thalassemias, you all know that alpha and beta thalassemia, all these thalassemia generally they are referring to the beta thalassemia. So alpha thalassemia will have a very early presentation. So this is a 21-year-old male, so we are talking about beta thalassemia. Okay, right. Now one more option is autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Okay, right, I'll come to that later. Now out of this beta thalassemia, you all know that beta thalassemia means it is a hemolytic disorder where the patient requires blood transfusion. But here you can see that the patient is 21 years old, but he has just needed only one blood transfusion. That means what? It is definitely not thalassemia major, because thalassemia major is itself described as transfusion dependent thalassemia. That means what? Every year, okay, in 1 or 2 months intervals, the patient would be requiring transfusion. So that is what's called transfusion dependent anemia. But here the patient is not dependent on transfusion. He is 21 years already, but he had just required only one transfusion. So thalassemia major can be ruled out. In thalassemia minor also can be ruled out, because thalassemia minor is usually a silent type of thalassemia wherein the patient doesn't require any transfusion and there is only very, very mild anemia, okay, like 10, 9 grams per deciliter, where the patient will not require blood transfusion, okay. So there is no requirement of blood transfusion in thalassemia minor. So that automatically brings us to the question, answer for this question, that is thalassemia intermedia, where the patient may require in between or infrequent transfusion. They are not transfusion dependent, but they would require infrequent transfusion. If the question is frequent blood transfusion, then it is thalassemia major. If it is infrequent blood transfusion, then it is thalassemia intermedia. No requirement of blood transfusion, it is thalassemia minor. Now you can ask me the question, why not it's autoimmune hemolytic anemia? I will tell you the points why it is not autoimmune hemolytic anemia. First, look at the gender. Autoimmune hemolytic anemia is more common in females rather than in the males. You all know that all autoimmune conditions are common in middle-aged females, not males. Number one. Number two is that these patients usually just not only present with anemia, they present with anemia along with jaundice. Prominently, they present to you with jaundice. Very, very rapid onset of jaundice. Okay, not only just anemia, are able to follow. So that's not given in the question. So again, autoimmune hemolytic anemia is not a probability. Third is, you can see that the patient had a similar episode of anemia 3 years back, but after that, he is not having any problems at all. That will not be the case in case of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. They will have frequent episodes. They will have frequent episodes of anemia with jaundice. This patient was not having frequent episodes, very infrequent episodes. Fourth is the treatment aspect. In autoimmune hemolytic anemia, they are not primarily managed with blood transfusion. Instead, they are managed with steroids. So that is why, because of all these reasons, I can confidently rule out autoimmune hemolytic anemia from this question. The answer is thalassemia intermedia. Right. Moving on to the next question. Anemia caused by antibodies against blood group antigen. It's a very, very simple question. Blood group or the RBC antigen. What is that? Now, what happens? It is something caused by antibodies. Hereditary spherocytosis is a membrane defect of the RBC, which is inherited. G6PD, again, similar explanation. G6PD deficiency repeated twice. I'm sorry for that. But all these options are ruled out. So what is the answer? It is obviously what? Hemolytic disease of newborn, which is caused by maternal antibodies to fetal RBC antigen, causing hemolysis. You all know that two important groups. What is that? One is ABO antibody. Next is RH antibody. This is what we refer to as hemolytic disease of newborn. And one more question often asked in your exam. Out of ABO and RH, which is more common? Please remember, the more common variety is ABO incompatibility. Please remember like this. Out of 10 cases of blood group incompatibility you get in pregnancy, 7 or 8 would be ABO incompatibility only. Only 1 or 2 will be RH incompatibility. But what is the point about RH incompatibility? If there is RH incompatibility, it is likely to be severe. That is the point. Okay, so these are two important questions. More common type is ABO incompatibility. Little rare variety is RH incompatibility, but RH is more severe compared to ABO incompatibility. That should be remembered. Moving on to the next question. A 75-year-old man who lives alone and prepares his own food presents with ekymotic patches in his lower extremities. Ekymotic patches are a type of bleeding manifestation. You all must have learnt in your pathology classes itself. Ekymosis, okay, in the skin. He is also found to have hemorrhagic areas around the hair follicle, that is follicular hemorrhage, okay, along with hematomas in the arms and the legs. PT, that is a prothrombin time, and CT, that is a clotting time, are all normal, likely cause. Okay, right. Now, whenever you look at a bleeding manifestation, okay, when you look at a bleeding manifestation, you think of three things. Okay, one is that it's a problem in the platelets. Second is problem in the coagulation. Third is the problem in the vessel wall. Problem is in the vessel wall. Now, in this particular scenario, I can confidently say that it is not a platelet problem because no mention of platelet count and clotting time is also normal. Next is there is no coagulation defect also because probably because it is mentioned that prothrombin time is also normal. Okay, you can always leave all these from the question because the question is not even asking about any of the platelet problem or the coagulation problem. It is all asking about some vitamin deficiencies, K, C, pyridoxine, vitamin A deficiency. This is, so by excluding the ones, okay, it is primarily a vessel wall problem. So which deficiency actually causes a vessel wall problem? Remember, vitamin K deficiency can cause bleeding, but vitamin K deficiency is often associated with a coagulation problem, because you all know that vitamin K is needed for activation of clotting factors. Activation of clotting factors. What are the clotting factors? 2, 7, 9 and 10. So rather, you will be having some coagulation problem type of bleeding, which is not the problem here. PT is absolutely normal, so there is no problem in the coagulation. Are you able to follow? So it's not vitamin K deficiency. Then what is the answer? Yes, some of you might have got it correct. It's a case of vitamin C deficiency. Now, what is the problem of this vitamin C deficiency? In vitamin C deficiency, what you are going to have is immature form of collagen. So what happened? The blood vessel will not have a proper structure of the vessel wall, or there is an inadequate support to the blood vessel. This is what is going to cause bleeding manifestation. Because of instability of the vessel wall due to immaturity of the collagen, these patients present with bleeding patch. Okay, right. Now, please remember, you can see the clinical scenario. Correlate with the clinical scenario. Okay, what is the richest source of vitamin C? Okay, it is the citrus fruits and the vegetables. Now, this is a 75-year-old man, okay, who is living alone and preparing his own foods. See, you all know that the patient may not be able to chew properly because he might have lost his teeth and all at 75 years of age. So he is mainly dependent on liquids. Second is that he will be mainly dependent on something like this bread along with the milk and all, okay, which will not contain adequate amount of vitamin C. He is practically not taking citrus fruits and vegetable. That would have predisposed this patient to develop vitamin C deficiency. So all these can be correlated, and the answer for this particular question is vitamin C deficiency, right? So whenever a patient presents with bleeding manifestation, one of the factors to be considered is vitamin C deficiency, but it is very rare. The common problem which can cause bleeding manifestations are a problem in the platelets or a problem in the coagulation pathway. Okay, how to differentiate is by the type of the bleeding which presents in this group of disorders. Okay, you can very classically see, okay, I have given you the tabular column, but what I wanted to emphasize is two important points. One is the location of bleeding. You can see here, superficial bleeding is a feature of platelet problem. Okay, either platelet deficiency or a platelet function problem. It can also be seen in vessel, but more important to be emphasized is a platelet deficiency causes this superficial type of bleeding or superficial ecchymosis. When we talk about the deep bleeding, okay, which is deep hematomas, hemarthrosis. What does that hemarthrosis means? Bleeding into the joint and delayed bleeding, all are very characteristic of coagulation pathway problems. Coagulation pathway problems. Okay, so these two points, if you can remember, superficial is for platelet problem, and deep bleeding as well as delayed bleeding is for coagulation problem. That would be helping you to differentiate what is the question and what is the type of bleeding disorder you are likely encountering in that particular question. Are you able to follow this? Right. Moving on to the next question. A 5-year-old boy is admitted with petechiae and ecchymosis, petechiae patches, obviously, and ecchymosis all over the body. He has no lymphadenopathy or organomegaly. All of the following are true statement. Whenever a patient has got lot of this petechiae and ecchymosis, what will you think of? These are superficial bleedings. And these are probably what type of bleeding? Superficial means what I told you? Platelet. And look at the clinical scenario. It's a child, a 5-year-old boy. Okay, right. He is not having any problem. There is no lymphadenopathy. There is no splenomegaly as well. All of the following are true except, that means they are asking about the false statement. First of all, before discussing the options, let me tell you what is the diagnosis here. Any of you ready with the diagnosis? Some of you must have already thought about it. It is nothing but a case of acute immune thrombocytopenic purpura or acute ITP. Okay, wherein what happens following a viral infection few weeks, okay, say 1 to 2 weeks later, the patient develops with sudden onset of thrombocytopenia, which is characterized by superficial bleeding manifestation. Okay, what is the basic problem would have been? it would have been development of something like autoantibodies against the platelet proteins, okay, or autoantibodies against the receptor, which are the proteins present in the platelet. That's what is the pathogenesis of acute ITP. This is a case of acute ITP, okay, right. So what do you think will be the problem? These antibodies are causing destruction of the platelets, is it not? So this patient will have decreased platelet in the blood. Option C is correct. Then what happened when the platelets are getting destroyed in the periphery, that means in the circulation, the bone marrow as a compensation tries to produce more of platelets. So there is increased megakaryocytes in the bone marrow. That's why it's a precursor for the platelet to be produced in the bone marrow. No? So that's why the bone marrow activity increases to compensate for this destruction of platelets in the peripheral blood. Okay, so there is increased megakaryocyte in the bone marrow. That's also correct. Now, please remember, acute ITP is something which is very, very characteristically known for spontaneous resolution in 80% of cases by 2 to 6 weeks. Okay, so once the antibody levels start decreasing in the blood, all of the patients will recover spontaneously. So that's also a correct statement. So that brings us to the answer for this particular question. Answer is bleeding into the joint. Straight away you can rule out this answer even if you do not know the other option. Why? Bleeding into the joints is a problem of coagulation defect. But what are we looking at here? Here we are looking at a platelet defect, which is a superficial type of bleeding. Okay, so obviously both those statements do not correlate with each other, and hence you can very easily arrive at the answer. Answer is bleeding into the joint, that's a feature of coagulation problem, but here we are dealing with a platelet problem. Move on to the next question. The most common manifestation of hemophilia A. You all know that hemophilia A is a clotting factor defect. Which factor? It is a factor 8. Okay, it is a factor 8 which is deficient in case of hemophilia A. Factor 9 deficiency is hemophilia B. Of course, hemophilia A is more common compared to hemophilia B. Now, all of you know that whenever there is a clotting factor defect, there is a deep bleeding. Okay, the question is the most common, or you can even put it like characteristic manifestation of hemophilia. Okay, this is nothing but a fact for you all to be remembered. Answer is recurrent heme arthrosis or bleeding into the joints. Very, very important. Usually the lower limb joints like the knee and the ankle are commonly affected in case of hemophilia A. This is just for you to remember. Of course, there can be other manifestations also, but the most common characteristic is recurrent heme arthrosis. Please make a note of it. Let's see the next question. A 16-year-old boy presents with the complaints of nosebleeds and bleeding after brushing his teeth for the past few months. Nosebleeds and brushing after the teeth means it is probably a case of mucosal bleeding. Okay, is it not? Nasal mucosa and the oral mucosa or the gingiva. It's a mucosal bleeding. Okay, right. That is number one clue. And this is a boy. Okay, you also notice few skin bruise on examination. So there is also skin bleeding. Skin bruise means skin bleeds. Now, what are the investigation reveals? Elevated APTT. That's a clue for us. There is an increased APTT. Okay. While prothrombin time and platelet counts are all normal. Okay. What is a likely diagnosis? Okay. Now, please remember, platelet count normal means what diagnosis automatically ruled out? Acute ITP is ruled out, because in acute ITP, you'll have low levels of platelet. In DIC can also be used out. Ruled out. What is DAC? DAC means you must have studied in pathology. What is that? Disseminated intravascular coagulation. In DAC, what happens? All the things will be abnormal. APTT will be abnormal. PT will be elevated. Platelet count also will be decreased. But here, PT and platelet counts are normal. So that rules out the diagnosis of DAC. In chronic liver disease also, you all know that liver is involved in the synthesis of clotting factors. Okay, clotting factors. So when the clotting factor level decreases, both APTT and PT should increase. But here APTT is increased, but PT is normal. So again, chronic liver disease also can be ruled out. And also remember, there is no other signs of chronic liver disease given in the question. So no way the answer can be chronic liver disease. So that brings us to the answer after eliminating the other options. The answer is von Willebrand's disease. Okay. You all know that von Willebrand disease is due to deficiency of this von Willebrand factor or abnormality in the function of the von Willebrand factor. And please note for your exam, this is an MCQ. So I will straight away tell that first, it is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. Please make a note of it. It is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. It characteristically presents with mucosal bleeds. Like for in this particular question, I have told you nasal bleeds and gum bleeds. Okay, in the females it can also present with the menstrual bleeds also. Okay, all these things are there. It is the most common inherited bleeding disorder. Okay, right. Now you have to answer the question, why APTT is elevated in this patient? You must have studied in pathology classes itself. Von Willebrand factor acts as a carrier for the factor or functioning of factor 8, is it not? So when von Willebrand factor is going to be abnormal, okay, or going to be absent, what is going to happen? The function of the factor 8 also is not going to happen properly. So that is why you are having increase in or prolongation of APTT. Okay, right. So that's about this particular question. Please remember, von Willebrand's disease, most common inherited bleeding disorder, is often asked as MCQs in your exams. Right. That brings us to the last question of the day. Which of the following is false regarding vitamin K deficiency? Okay. Associated thrombocytopenia deficiency is rarely seen except in infants. Warfarin cause vitamin K deficiency. Factor 8 is first to be affected. Very obvious answer for this question is associated thrombocytopenia, because in vitamin K deficiency, you are having a problem in coagulation factor activation. 2, 7, 9 and 10 coagulation factor activated. So that is why there is no problem in the platelet assay. So that is why associated thrombocytopenia is outright wrong statement in this particular question. So very easily you can tell the answer just by looking at the first option itself. Deficiency is rarely seen except in infants. That is correct. Because remember, in infants, they are primarily dependent on breast milk for their vitamin K. Okay. But remember, vitamin K is absent in the breast milk. Okay. So that is why deficiency is commonly seen in vitamin in breastfeeding infants. So that is why for prevention, what do you do for newborn babies? For prevention of vitamin K deficiency, what do you do? Yes, at birth itself, you give intramuscular injection of vitamin K in the anterolateral aspect of the thigh. Okay, so to prevent this vitamin K deficiency bleeding. Warfarin causes vitamin K deficiency, very, very well known fact. All of you must have learnt in your pharmacology classes itself. It interferes with the activation of vitamin K. So what happens? Activation of coagulation factors also will not happen. So that is why warfarin is associated with vitamin K deficiency, and that's a correct statement. Factor 10 is the first to be affected, and that's also a correct statement. Okay, right. So please remember, which is false, outright false statement is associated thrombocytopenia. Okay, right. And if there is a vitamin K deficiency, it obviously causes bleeding, and the name which we give for vitamin K deficiency bleeding is called as hemorrhagic disease of newborn. It's called hemorrhagic disease of newborn. Are you able to follow? Please don't confuse this with hemolytic disease of newborn. Hemolytic disease of newborn means blood group incompatibility, like ABO incompatibility or RH incompatibility. But hemorrhagic disease of newborn is vitamin K deficiency. Right. So thank you all for watching this video. I'm also planning further videos for students appearing for this FMG exams. Please feel free to share this video with your friends. And if you have any doubts, please put it up in the comment section. Please subscribe to the channel by pressing on the subscribe button. And don't forget to turn on the bell icon, because you will get notified of the new videos as and when they are posted to this channel. So I will see you all soon in another video. Still then, study well and take care. Have a good day. Thank you.